Welcome to Legacies, a journey through the interesting lives of elders. My name is Roberta Robinson. I'm Director of Marketing and Outreach for Geriatric Division of the Cambridge Health Alliance. This program is a collaboration between the Cambridge Health Alliance and SCATV. Often we meet people today and find out exactly what's going on with them at present time. We rarely have the time to find out what their lives have been like, and some of them have had pretty incredible lives. We hope you enjoy. Today we have with us EJ Johnson. And EJ lives in JFK in Cambridge on 55 Essex Street.
Correct.
In a supportive housing apartment. Now, EJ, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad you're here. Thank you. And tell us a little bit about what's going on with you today, just so the folks have a sense of all the things you've accomplished in your life.
Well, do you want to talk about the disease a little bit first?
Yes.
I have a rare muscle disease called inclusion body myositis, more commonly known as IBM. And it's an inflammatory myopathy. It's a disease where my muscles secrete enzymes, and they are attacked by white blood cells, so they cause atrophy in my muscles. So I've had it since 1959 and lost a lot of muscle mass. And so it affects your legs, your arms, your hands. I can't make a fist anymore. It's affecting my voice today. Mm. I'm starting to slur a little, but hopefully my voice will ramp up a little better. And when I first got it, literally it was a pain in the butt. I had a little pain in my rear end walking upstairs and ignored it because it was no big deal. But when I went for my physical that year, I mentioned it to my physician's assistant, not a doctor, and she immediately said, "Ooh, that could be a muscle disease. I'm going to send you to a neurologist."
That's amazing.
Yeah. And she did, and it took about 4 months to be diagnosed, lots of visits to the neurologist. And it's a progressive disease. Every month I can measure something that I can't do as well as I could before. The good news is there's no pain involved.
That is good news.
Yeah, very good news. Just weakness. You have to be, you know, grateful for the good. You got to look at the glasses half full. I don't have to tell you that.
No, absolutely. And the good news is you have this power wheelchair, which gives you as much independence as possible. That's also good news.
And it's great news. Yeah, I would be really just. Well, I could be in a chair, but bedridden, or just, you know, indoors all day doing nothing without the wheelchair.
Exactly. So let's go back a little bit.
Okay.
And let's start with where you grew up.
Okay. I grew up in Tewksbury, Mass. I lived in Malden until I was five, mm-hmm. but we moved to Tewksbury, and I went to Tewksbury schools, graduated from Tewksbury High School. I want to throw in I was a model student until sophomore year, and then I, as they say, came out of my shell and became the class clown in the honors division. And did a lot of ad-libbing in class, didn't study quite as hard, and but just realized I didn't want to be a math science person and that I wanted to get into something creative.
Okay, and so then where did your path take you there?
I wrote a lot of jingles in high school for school dances and class projects. But anyway, I decided I wanted to become a writer. And so I applied to BU, to the communications school, got accepted at COM, I thought I was going to be a journalism major and become a writer. And they required that you take a sampler course from each of the departments over your first 2 years. And my very first one was broadcasting and film.
Ah.
And so I was in a studio like this, and I said, "This is it. This is what I want to do." And I never wavered from that.
Really? That's wonderful. And how old were you at that point?
Well, I was a freshman in college, so I was 17.
That's
I was a young freshman. And, you know, I hear stories about students transferring and changing their major and taking 30 credits of extra courses. I was 120 credits at the end of the 4 years, never changed anything, and never really wanted to do anything else.
Wow. So from there, what where did you...
Well, I started looking for a job. It wasn't easy in Boston. And one day a guy knocked on my door and said, "Hi, I'm Dave Pradell. I got your name from Professor Polito, and he recommended you, and I'm starting a film group as part of Summer Thing, the Mayor's Summer Community Festival. We're going to be making films with young kids, young teens, inner city kids. Would you like to work with me?" And I didn't have a job, so of course I said sure.
But that was the Summer Thing, just so folks know, the Summer Thing under Mayor Kevin White.
Yeah, it was back in like 1969. So that turned into a year-round thing. My boss got a grant from Eastman Kodak, and we moved from one site to another and ended up in an old fire station in the Bay Village. And so I made a lot of films with 13, 14-year-old kids. After 2 years, they wanted to do a promotional film about Summer Thing. And so they, you know, my boss said, "Do you want to shoot a film, a sound film?" We were doing films, shooting silent and adding music and effects.
Oh.
We didn't have a sound on camera. That's the beauty of video today. But we were shooting 16-millimeter film. And so we had to add that sound. So I said, "Sure, I would love to do something that's my own." And so WBZ loaned us a camera and gave us a bunch of film and said, "If it's any good, we'll air it." So when it was done, it was pretty good. And they decided to air it on a Sunday night at 8 p.m. Sounds good, but it was against Bobby Orr and Game 5 of the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Oh.
So my mother called my uncle and he said, "I'm not watching that film. I'm watching the Bruins." But the Bruins swept the series in 4 games. There was no Game 5. And so my film got on at 8 p.m. on Sunday night, and all of my relatives got to watch it.
There you go. Yeah. It was destined to
be. I guess, yeah.
Yeah.
So, and then after that, I decided I liked doing my own stuff. It was time to leave the film center. And I got involved with some independent films. I worked on some films. One called The Dozens, which was shot at Framingham State Prison.
Oh.
I worked on the crew on that, not a big job, but I... and then I worked on a lot of films made by a company called Blackside, which was owned by Henry Hampton, who was the man who won the Academy Award for Eyes on the Prize.
Oh.
He was a great man. And so it was, you know, and his crews would be 70% black, young black filmmakers. So it was kind of a privilege to get to work with them. And then after that, that was one of the things I was doing. I worked on a film for the police department, one for the fire department, again with a friend who was a black producer. And then I worked on an adventure film. It was kind of a low budget film, what they would call a B movie. This was in 1975. Today, it's hard to do those low-budget things because Jaws, which came out that year, just jacked the budgets up on films.
Oh.
You know, Jaws was a $100 million film. It was supposed to be like $33 million. And when it made so much money, Hollywood started making Close Encounters of the Third Kind and all the mega-budget films.
Oh.
And so there were no more legitimate films at $2 million and independent films at $400,000. You know, that
kinda
just hurt the independent filmmaker. But anyway, I worked on those kind of things.
And when at what point in your career were you doing the jingles for BZ?
Oh, no, the jingles were high school.
Oh, they
but
were.
That'll be after I started working at Robert Gilmore Associates.
Ah.
So that would be kind of the next step. I went on from there and started freelancing for Gilmore Productions in Denham, Mass. They were the second video production company in Boston. Until then, all local commercials were shot mostly on 16 millimeter film because video was not portable. You could do a commercial at the studio. And then finally, they started making portable one-inch machines that could go out in the field. And that machine weighed like 80 pounds.
Oh.
So it's portable only in name. And the camera, you know, would be cabled up to that. And you could go out in the field and shoot a commercial. And the beauty of that was it's video. You can see playback. You can see what you're getting. So you know if it's good or not on film. You had no playback. Hmm. And film had a sort of beauty to it. And expensive commercials continued to be shot on film. But the advent of electronic news gathering cameras and portable video just changed the production industry. Suddenly there were hundreds of producers. Hmm. You could have either a whole company, a whole facility, or you could just have an office and hire everything freelance, but it was a boon to the industry. And so I freelanced for Gilmore Productions about 5 or 6 times, and then they said, would you like to come here and work? And so the video was new to me, and everybody thought it was hugely different than film, but it really was the same technique. Not a big difference, and film was more tricky because you had to learn how to expose it properly. You could mess it up.
Right.
Video, of course, you see what you're getting. If something isn't right, you do it again.
Right, like the computer versus the typewriter, right. Kind of.
Yeah. Right, so it was really going in an easier direction. But the beauty of video was that it didn't cost you much money to roll the camera. Film, every time you pull the trigger, every time you started rolling, it was costing dollars. And so you had to, use your film sparingly. And again, hope it was all good.
Right.
And so you had lots of trained eyes on what was going on a crew. And, with a little luck, it came out well.
Right. So at what point, had you married yet or?
No. I worked at Gilmore Productions probably for about 7 years when I got engaged. And I think I was married for the last 2 years I was there.
Oh.
I married a woman who was 16 and a half years younger than I am. So that's probably one reason why it didn't work out in the end. But, we had a son. I have a great son. And we have a very amicable divorce.
That's wonderful.
Very amicable. So.
Something to be said for that, and we don't hear about that often.
Well, life is too short to be holding grudges, right?
I agree. Were you listening to my talk this morning? I agree with you wholeheartedly.
But I am drinking the Roberta Robinson Kool-Aid. So.
Well, yeah. That's good. It's working, and that's great.
That's right.
We appreciate that. Okay, so then that brings us to what point in your career?
Well, I was there for 10 years. That's really where I learned lighting. Mm-hmm. I learned lighting because when we would have a high budget job, they would hire a high budget lighting director. And if you know what's going on, you only have to watch a little to learn. If you're not paying attention, you don't learn anything. And if you know nothing, then you don't know the good from the bad. But once you know a little, then you could watch what other people are doing, say, oh, I see what he's doing. And why? And suddenly it's yours. So to be called a director of photography, you really have to be a lighting cameraman. The camera moves are no big deal.
Hmm.
Most people can learn that, but some are better than others. But I learned to light, and it was a great experience because we worked on commercials for like New England, regional and local, not national, but regional commercials. New England Toyota dealers, the New England Subaru, Boston Herald, Ground Round Restaurant, they're no longer, I think, in business.
Right.
Pizzeria Uno. And I used to do news promos for WBZ.
I knew WBZ was in there somewhere.
I did one. We won an award for one with Bob Lobel. Do you remember
Bob
Lobel?
Yes, he was a sports announcer.
He was probably the most famous Boston sports anchor in the history of Boston television. But we did a spoof on broadcast news where he was editing frantically in an edit room, ran down the hallway. We had a dolly shot with him running and the camera zipping along. And then we had a stunt double, and he vaulted over the anchor desk back when they weren't clear plexiglass, vaulted over the anchor desk and popped up on the backside. And they had a lot of fun with that because the next night they were laughing about it. It was getting some notice. And they played it in slow-mo, and the stunt guy wore the suit and everything, the black shoes, but he left his white socks on. And Bob Lobel said, let's face it, I wouldn't be wearing white socks with a suit. So that's not me jumping the desk. So those were fun experiences. And then the corporate work, we did work for General Electric, for MetLife, Data General, Digital Equipment Corp, Dunkin' Donuts. Oh. Shot training videos at Dunkin' Donut University out in Braintree.
Oh, I know it well.
Yeah. And so it was varied. And I preferred the commercials, but commercial people could be mean and brutal at times. And so if I had gotten beaten up a little by somebody, the corporate thing would come along and everybody was really nice and really happy, you know. And so it was nice to kind of go from one thing to another.
The balance.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And then, so then did you do freelance photography on your own? Did you?
Yeah, I, after I was at Gilmore Productions for about 10 years, it was during the first, the George H.W. Bush administration, and there was a kind of a recession near the end of that, and it hit all the video production companies. Suddenly, everybody's business was dropping off a little. They were laying off. And my boss made some very bad business decisions to go with it. And so in the space of a month, the company virtually went out of business. And so I stayed longer than the salespeople, and they took all the accounts with them. So everybody, they all left with something to sell, and I left with only me. And so I went back to freelancing, and the first thing I did was call MetLife because we had done some good work for them, and I said, gee, I hear you got a new studio, and if you ever need a freelancer to come down and shoot or do whatever, you know, give me a call. And so they said, well, how about next week? And I probably worked for them about 80 days a year for the next 15 years. So they were my cash cow. Hmm. And then other accounts were random. Mm-hmm. And one thing I always felt was you got to have one cash cow, one company you can kind of depend on. And so I used to shoot about 3 days a week, which was enough. And later in along in that, when I got married, I must have started this at Gilmore. I had a friend videotape my wedding. And so then Teresa's roommate was getting married in 2 weeks, and I had this camcorder that I bought from my friend to tape my wedding. So I thought, well, I'll videotape hers. And after that, people saw her video, and they wanted me to tape the wedding. And I started doing it as a side business, and at like $350. Well, by the time I was done, it was a big industry. Almost none of the people doing it had real professional experience. And you know, I was charging like basic price of $15.95, and that was not high.
Right.
I just didn't have the heart to charge too much, but there were people videoing weddings for $3,000, $6,000, doing tons of editing, but the shooting was terrible. And you can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. You know, if you don't have good footage, God help you in the edit room.
Right. So you had a pretty fulfilling career. I mean, you loved doing what you were doing.
Right.
And then we'll fast forward to after your diagnosis, and you got referred to me. One of the things I do is work with a program called the PACE program, Elder Right. Service Plan. And when I first met you in Belmont, you were in a similar situation. Your muscles had started to atrophy, and you you were disadvantaged in many ways, and you would rigged up so many of these. I mean, I give you A for creativity, but it scared me to death when I saw that on a wing and a prayer you were doing this, and it was just amazing that you didn't have a catastrophic accident. And so let's talk about how the program has been able to support. And I found EJ, and we enrolled him in the program, and then we were able to move him to a supportive housing. And then you trusted me to move again only after a month when I told you it was the sweetest deal I could ever offer
you. And it was. You weren't lying.
So. No, I never lie.
And I'm very beholden.
And so now you're in an apartment that has, you have assistance when you need it.
Right.
And you have the equipment that you need.
Power and chair that goes up and down some to help me get out of it. And a hospital bed that goes up and down. I can actually walk a little bit, but I walk like a penguin. I walk with my knees locked. If my knees bend more than a little, I go down like the World Trade Center. So I walk like that. Mm. So I have to be able to sit on the side of the hospital bed. And even the bed doesn't go quite high enough, but if I sit down where it raises the legs, I call that the knee hump on the bed, and sit over that, I get up to about 32 inches, which is a little higher than a normal table height. Mm-hmm. And if there I can slide off with my knees locked. Once I'm up, I can walk a little with a walker. Mm. So I can get to and from the bathroom and shower, and then at night I can get out of the chair and make it back to the bed.
Wonderful. And so with all of this equipment, let's just talk a little bit about how you're still working. You're working one day a week over
at the Belmont Media Center.
Still doing the things you love to do.
Yep.
And without all of this support and this equipment, you might not be doing it.
I couldn't get there. I take the ride. I have to, you know, get a wheelchair. I started working there. I've been there about 8 years, and when I started, I was just using a cane and driving, but then I went to two canes, and then I think I went, I got into the program, and I got the chair.
Right.
And I got off the road, which was good for the rest of the drivers.
I see a lot of people on the road still.
I was using my cane on the gas for the last 2 months. Only driving a mile a day back and forth to work because I needed the money.
Yeah.
And that was before I got in the program.
And got into subsidized
housing. Well, yeah, I had private insurance, and that ran out. And so when I was on SSDI, I was getting at that time like $1,500 a month, and my rent was $1,350. And I said, well, these economics don't work. And I had a little money left in the bank. But, you know, that's when I started looking around for the solution, and the PACE program was the solution.
It was the solution. And, you know, I'm blessed that we were able to help you and to support you to allow you to keep the level of independence that you've been able to keep, irrespective of everything that's going on and the, you know, the increase of symptoms with this disease. So I, if it doesn't show anyone anything, I hope it shows that possibilities are unlimited. And attitude is everything. You have a fabulous attitude, and that helps, right? You have a choice, as we know, to look at the glass, as you said, half empty or half full. And I certainly hope that this is a way for us to share your experience, your strength, and hope for everyone else that, you know, possibilities are unlimited. We can do whatever we want to do in life,
right.
And there's always a way to do it.
And that's the thing I think I got out of my career. I was basically a problem solver. How are we going to do this for not $5 million, but $5,000? And you sit in brain cells. Well, the same thing when I needed special accommodations and that weren't in the handicap catalog. I said, well, what could I build? And I couldn't build it myself anymore, but I could design it and get my son to build it. You know, might be a little ramp or something. I have a little ramp in the apartment now that I drive this up on because it doesn't go quite high enough for me to get off.
Uh-huh.
But that's how I get off. And so if you put your mind to something, you can make things happen.
Absolutely, absolutely. And if there is, that's probably the best message that we could give to anybody watching this show, right? That possibilities are unlimited. You put the intention out there, and the universe will match it up for you. Well, thank you. Thank you so much for joining us for this show. And I hope that the hope and the strength of, and the attitude of EJ will open your brain cells and allow you to do whatever it is that you want to do, irrespective of what challenges you may have in life. Thank you for watching.